service room. So I went from zero to my own hero. You helped me down, but I got up. Already brushing all the dust. You hear my voice, you hear that sound. Like thunder gonna shake the ground. You helped me down, but I got up. Ready, cause it hurt enough. I see it all, I see it all.
Well, it looks like we have most people in the room. So we will go ahead and get started. My name is Abby Lutzenkirchen. I am the program associate at the Arthur M. Blank Family Foundation, and I help lead the giving of the Atlanta Falcons Youth Foundation, which is an affiliated fund of the Blank Foundation. The Atlanta Falcons Youth Foundation is focused on finding innovative approaches to increase time kids spend in physical activity, especially for children who are most likely to miss out or opt out of being active. I'm so pleased to welcome you to the GEM Funder Briefing today. We're so glad you could join us and take some time during your lunch hour to get to know us and talk about our new statewide initiative to improve the health and lives of girls across the state of Georgia. In 2017, newest Georgia statewide fitness gram data showed an alarming disparity in the levels of aerobic capacity between girls and boys. As many of you may know, aerobic capacity isn't about your body fat or your body image, but it's about your cardiovascular health of an individual. It's about how many times you can get up and down the stairs without being winded. The data showed that 41% of girls in middle school are in the healthy fitness zone for heart health, compared to 57% of boys. And the data, which was the most alarming to us, showed that in fifth grade, 51% of middle school girls were in the healthy fitness zone for aerobic capacity. And by 12th grade, that number dropped to 31%. So with this data, the Atlanta Falcons Youth Foundation Committee was really alarmed and we wanted to make a change. So we led a 3-year process in which stakeholders considered one big question. Why is this drop in physical activity happening during middle school girls' years? And how can we motivate and empower over 200,000 middle school girls to get moving? So we partnered with Spitfire Strategies to dive into the why of this data through expert interviews, social media scans, girl listening sessions, and focus groups. The results informed several middle school girl physical activity pilot grants, one including an initiative that was led by Health Empowers and the Southeastern Dairy Alliance. Through the pilot work and focus groups with middle school girls, the girls shared with us the key issues that can prevent girls at this age from being active. We found that the problem isn't the girls, it's their environment. Girls need voice and change. They need programming that's scalable, cooperative, accessible, regardless of their ability or skill level. So the Falcons Youth Foundation put our heads together with Health Empowers. And we figured out that the solution is girl-led programming with trained adult facilitators, with these girls leading and establishing healthy social emotional climate to allow these girls a safe space to explore new physical activity opportunities while also developing leadership and emotional resiliency skills. Through the launch of this initiative, the Girls Empowering Movement, or GEM, Health Empowers and its partners are poised to take this crisis on, even in the face of an unprecedented period in history where the need and focus of health is more than ever. The outcomes we hope to achieve are centered around aerobic capacity because that's the key leverage point for this issue. The standard outcome measures for all partners include increased girl physical activity levels, improve leadership and support, and their cardiovascular fitness. But most importantly, this program is created by girls and for girls. So with that, I would like to introduce you to our next speaker, Dr. Brenda Fitzgerald. She was the 17th director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and the administrator of the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry. Dr. Fitzgerald served as the commissioner of the Georgia Department of Public Health and state health officer from 2011 to 2017. Dr. Fitzgerald, a board-certified obstetrician-gynecologist, has practiced medicine for over three decades. So I would like to introduce you and give the floor to Dr. Fitzgerald.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to be here. And if you'll bring the first slide up, please. We are so pleased to be participating in the GEM program, and it's a wonderful idea. Next slide, please. When I was the commissioner of the Georgia Department of Public Health, we were number two as far as the second worst for childhood obesity in the entire United States. And the SHAPE legislation was passed in 2009, but we first started collecting data in 2011, the first year that I was commissioner for the Department of Public Health. The SHAPE stands for the School Health and Physical Education Act. And as was mentioned, we were looking at not just weight. We didn't want to just measure our children's weight. We wanted to measure their health. And so we looked at aerobic capacity. And meaningful data was collected with a lot of different partners. The bill was passed because diverse partners came together. We had healthcare providers, funders, philanthropic organizations, subject matter experts, academics like Dr. Debbie Kilby, Dr. Rodney Lynn at Georgia State, and many others, and implementation experts like Christy Kay from Health and Powers and Trace McGuire, the Department of Education. So next, please. This data is available statewide, and we can look at it, and we need to look at it so that we can measure our progress. Whenever you put a new program in, you think it's going to be great, and that's certainly the hope, but you want to measure progress. If you don't measure what you're doing, it may sound good, but it may not be as good as we need. So the second thing I wanted to say, and this comes from being the commissioner, but also seeing patients and looking at it at the national level from CDC, physical activity and mental health are incredibly intertwined. And with COVID in this year, there's been decreased activity, and there's been increased mental problems in youth. Parents report 49% of parents report that their teenage children have had worsening or new mental health problems during COVID. And we know that there's been a dramatic increase in emergency room visits for behavioral health problems during this time. We also know, so one, there's a crisis. Two, I want to say, with all the people we brought together, we went from number two to number 19 now, as far as childhood obesity. So we know that when diverse people come together, we can make a change. And we also know that youth-led solutions are paramount. Peer-to-peer works. When you look at the Mental Health of America report, and they ask teenagers what they wanted, they want to be in control of their health, and they trust their peers. So that is absolutely paramount. Next, please. So my point is to say, we certainly know that we have a problem. We have a problem that's been made dramatically worse by COVID. It is a crisis area. We have listened to girls. Population change is possible. Sustainability and success are in sight. And now is the time to act. Thank you very much. Abby, you're muted.
Sorry, I was on mute. Awesome. Thank you so much, Dr. Fitzgerald. Wouldn't be a Zoom webinar without someone talking on mute. So I just thought I'd get it out of the way for everyone else. I would like to introduce Gigi Aiden. She is a sixth grader from Factory Shoals Middle School in Douglas County, and she is going to lead us through a physical activity pool activity.
Hi. Okay. So we're going to start off with some jumping jacks, and you can sit or stand up. It doesn't matter. If you do choose to sit, you can just use your arms like this. If you do choose to stand, well, you know, use your feet. Okay, so we're in 15, all right? Let's, one, two, three, one, start. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. Oh, we passed. Okay, well, now we're gonna do some squats. You can use a chair. So we're doing 15 squats. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Sorry, we went overboard, but that's okay. Now we're going to do some high knees. So you can sit down for doing your high knees. First, if you are sitting down, you do choose to sit down. Just put your knee up to your chest. Makes it a lot easier if you do choose to sit down. If not, you can stand up. We're doing 15 high knees. Ready? Go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay, we did 15 high knees. This time we didn't go overboard. Good. Okay, for this one, we're doing arm circles. If you want, you can sit down or stand up. I'll choose to sit down for this one. Arm circles, okay? You're going to put it outwards and rotate them circular motion. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay, we're gonna stretch now. So pull your left arm. 1, 2, 3. Now the right arm. 1, 2, 3. Now you're gonna do above your head. 1, 2, 3. Now the left one. 1, 2, 3. Okay, that's great. Now we're gonna do some deep breathing. Okay, we're gonna inhale for 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. Now we're gonna exhale for 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. Now we're gonna do that two more times. 1, 2, 3. Exhale. 1, 2, 3. One more time. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Good job.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Gigi. That was great. I hope everyone's heart rate is up and you are more alert for the next part of our presentation. Next up, we have Joni Taylor, who is the women's head basketball coach at the University of Georgia. She is the 2021 Southeastern Conference Coach of the Year and two-time National Coach of the Year semifinalist. During the 2020-2021 campaign, Coach Taylor guided her team to fourth place finish in the SEC standings after they were being picked ninth in the conference's preseason polls. Her success is not solely what happens on the court. She's been heavily involved in the Athens community, creating the award-winning Beyond Basketball, a meeting place for women in Athens to discuss happenings and issues in and around the area. So without further ado, I'd like to have Coach Taylor come to the floor.
Hi, how's everybody doing? Gigi, thank you for leading us through those exercises. That was awesome. I'm so excited to be with you guys today and just really share a little bit about why it's so important for young women to be involved in sports. You're looking at a great example of it. I am from Meridian, Mississippi, and if it were not for basketball, I would not be sitting in front of you today. It is what got me to college. My parents would not have been able to afford to give me a full scholarship otherwise. And once I figured that out in about seventh or eighth grade, that was my ticket. And I dialed into it and I had people around me. I had the support of my community, my middle school, my junior high, my high school, and other organizations that poured into me and people like me in my community. And if it weren't for that, I would not be here. I went to the University of Alabama. The first time that I got on a plane was when I got to college. I'd never been on a plane before. Basketball has provided me so many opportunities. Sport has provided me so many opportunities and allowed me to travel and see things that for free that I would have never otherwise been able to do And now it is literally what my profession. And so I think that there are so many walking examples and living examples of why women in sports is so important. And it needs to start at a very, very young age. I've got a few statistics that I just really want to share with you that I think are really important and eye-opening. I know they were for me when I first heard it a long time ago. So according to a study of women by Ernst & Young, in the C-suite, we know our CEOs, our C-suite women. 94% of C-suite women are former athletes. 52% of them were college student athletes. And 61% of former female athletes who were surveyed believe participation in athletics contributed to their success. Why? Because it teaches time management. It teaches you to learn how to communicate and work with people from different and diverse backgrounds. Inclusion is something that you're going to have if you're involved in sports at any age. It brings people together from different backgrounds to fight for a common goal and to figure things out. It challenges you. It makes you uncomfortable. And all of those are qualities that you're going to need in life, no matter what it is that you do. What's also very staggering to me is the number of which young women stop participating in sports. And so young girls and women drop out of sports at 1.5 times the rate of boys by the age of 14. So that 11 to 13 age range is really, really important for our young girls to make sure that we are putting the support around them and encouraging them to stay involved. 7 in 10 girls who dropped out during their puberty years said that their decision was because they felt they didn't belong, right? And so we've got to do everything we can to provide environments, plenty of opportunities for them to feel, have more than one choice. If it wasn't for the Boys and Girls Club before I became active, I'm not sure if I would have stayed involved, but we need more options. So we need more options for young women so they don't feel like there's only one place they can turn to be active. By age 17, 50% of girls will have stopped playing sports. 2 in 3 girls believe society doesn't encourage girls to participate in sports. Now, I'm going to go off on a little tangent here and tell you that that is valid, because I don't know how many of you followed the NCAA tournament this year, but the inequities in the bubble, that was a big conversation, right? You know, we were in San Antonio, the men were in Indianapolis, and you from the weight rooms to the swag bags to the food to the logos and the signage that was provided for the men and not for the women, there were so many things. And of course, the focus was on the inequities in the bubble, but at a higher level, it's a governance problem. It's a structural problem. And it's a belief that men's sports are more important than women's sports. And that's just not true, and it's not fair. And so I do believe that stat that says 2 in 3 girls believe society doesn't encourage girls or women to participate in sports or value it. So their reasons for dropping out is that they feel that success isn't attainable in sports, which in reality, participation in sports has many benefits, including higher grades and higher educational aspirations. Young women also believe that there isn't a future in them playing sports. And actually, sports are proven to make participants happier, healthier, and more confident in life. Girls have 1.3 million fewer opportunities to play high school sports than boys, and we need to make sure that they're in a position to take advantage of those opportunities. So the best way to keep girls playing is to encourage them, to let them know that they belong and have reasons to play that extend far beyond physical fitness. For all the things that we talked about before, the life lessons that come along with it. You know, learning how to communicate is a life lesson, no matter what you decide to do. Learning how to be in a diverse environment and be inclusive is a life lesson, no matter what you decide to do. Figuring out how to handle tough things is a life lesson, no matter what it is you decide to do. Experiencing failure. Most women who participate in sports handle failure a lot better and bounce back quicker because they've had to deal with it and figure it out. Sometimes you just have to figure things out, and sports allows you to do that. So all those things are so important, and it's why this group is so special, because we have an opportunity to help lead the charge in making sure that our young girls are active in sports, they're excited about sports, and they believe in it. And all it takes is the right person and one person letting them know, how special it is in providing an opportunity. So thank you for your time. I know you guys have a packed agenda. I'm so grateful to have the opportunity to speak to you. It's obviously something that I'm very, very passionate about. It's my life's work. And we don't get young ladies at our level if they don't stay involved at your level. So please, do all that you can to donate, to participate, to give of your time, to give financially, to make sure that we are providing opportunities for our young girls to participate in sports. Maybe not because they're going to become a professional athlete, but because they're going to be running a C-suite business one day, and they need all those skills that sports provides. So thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Coach Taylor, thank you so much. That was absolutely incredible. Hi, everybody. My name is Sequoia Howard, and I am one of the school managers at Health Empowers. I was fortunate enough to be a part of that initial pilot that that Abby mentioned earlier, and I am so grateful to be a part of this portion of the project. Right here on the screen, you see these wonderful faces. This is our gym leadership team, and we actually have a few of the leaders on the call with us today. So as I announce their names, I need y'all to do me a really big favor. Down at the very bottom of your screen, there is a reactions button. I need y'all to give all the hand claps, all the celebrations. Let's make it real big for them. Let's go ahead and bring Callie to the stage. Let's go ahead and bring Ashaya to the stage. You all have seen Gigi already. Welcome Gigi to the stage, as well as Pratima. Hello. And Kendall, you can go ahead and take that slide down for me. Awesome. I want to see everybody's faces. I think we are missing Pratima. Let's see those emojis one more time, those hand claps, those celebrations. Woo! These are our leaders. They are absolutely incredible. I've had, along with Caroline, Leanne, several others, we have had the opportunity to work with these incredible leaders over the past 6 or 7 months or so, probably a little more. in putting this project on, and they are absolutely dynamic. So we're going to hear a bit from them, from their voices, about what this project really is all about, what all it means to them. Hey, ladies, how are y'all? So good to see you. Pratima, I need you to come up just a little bit so that we can see your shirt really quick. There you go. Oh, y'all see that hotness? Oh, yeah. We're going to talk a little bit about that in just a moment. Beautiful. Thank you so much. So first of all, I want to start off talking to you, Ashaya, about how gym has impacted you. We've heard a bunch of the stats already, and I want to hear how it's impacted you so far.
Hey, Sequoia, Ashaya's having some technical difficulties.
Okay, cool. Pratima, I'm going to ask you the same question then. How has gym impacted you?
So basically, gym has impacted me in many different ways. So one example is that it taught me how powerful teamwork is. So let me start from March 2020, the month of lockdown. I'm actually a big culprit of using my phone and my MacBook for watching Netflix and going on Snapchat, making TikToks. My screen time had multiplied by 10 because of lockdown. Now, when we started to have the meetings for gym, which was once every 2 weeks, it had taught me how to use technology for a good cause, which is another thing this program has taught me. And now I realize that when we as a team come together, we could accomplish anything because of all the passion we all put from our sides towards this program.
Yes, I absolutely love how you've seen how technology can be used in a great way. Thank you, Pratima. Ashaya, are you back with us? Not just yet, okay. Gigi, I want to hear from you really quickly about how gym has impacted you. Also, thank you for the phenomenal pick-me-up with the physical activity. Your energy is so infectious and you're incredible. So how has gym impacted you?
Thank you. Gym has impacted me in many ways. For one, when I started gym, I didn't really know what to expect. I was a really shy person. And now that I have been in gym for like a really long time, not that long, a minute now, but it has really helped me get out of my comfort zone. Now I can talk to many people and not be shy and just stay in one bubble. I have helped girls like in many ways. I want to motivate them a lot more than I used to. And I just see that whenever I motivate somebody or they motivate me, we can change the world. We can change anything. And we can just do everything.
Yeah, incredible. Absolutely incredible. So Ashaya, okay, so over the next few years, we are working really hard to train over 7,000 girls. Did I lose you again, Ashaya? Oh no, okay. I really want to hear from you, Callie. So I'll pose the question to you then. So we are looking to train over 7,000 girls over 7,000 leaders over the next few years and impacting, as someone said earlier, over 200,000 girls across the state. Why just girls?
So here at GEM, we're focused on girls, and a lot of people would say that like everyone should be included in trying to increase physical activity levels. That is true, but right now we really need to focus on girls because we've seen the trends in all the data. We've seen that girls are the ones having these huge disparities and gaps in between like grades and ages, and even between boys and girls. Girls, I think it was like 10% lower physical aerobic capacity, and that's just not healthy. And we don't need to provide things for people who aren't necessarily struggling as much. Like, for example, if someone fell on like a playground or something, the teacher's not gonna give the kid who didn't fall a Band-Aid. She's gonna give the kid who fell a Band-Aid. So we really just need to help the people who need help. And right now, the people who need help are girls.
Snaps for all of that, Callie. That was perfect. So you guys have developed a bunch of different resources, been a part of creating all of these amazing things. Some of them you mentioned a little bit, Callie. Fatima, tell me what makes this particular project so different from other physical activity projects that you've heard of or been a part of?
So this program, for starters, is created by girls for girls. Now, most physical activity programs, which I see outside, is for people in the middle school age group, is either like run by people who are older than that age group, or just that program just isn't as appealing to that age group. So the girls in our team know how other girls think, how they feel, how they would react to certain things. Therefore, this program will be more appealing than, in my opinion, any other program I see outside for the girls across Georgia.
Thank you, Fatima. So with this being for girls, by girls, you all, you along with the 11 other leaders, you all have worked really, really hard. So Gigi, tell me about some of the things that the leadership team has accomplished this year.
We have accomplished many things. For one, we are having a meet in like less than 2 months. And it's going to be really big. No, we can't wait for this meeting. So we had to get started with putting quotes, putting our notebooks, putting water bottles. We just can't wait to see these girls and their faces when they just see that there's some place here in the world where we can understand them and where we can talk to them. And also we have accomplished by our logo, by our name, by everything, because we are just amazing. We accomplished many things in like a couple of months, and like less than a year, and it's just like it's really unbelievable.
Yeah, you all are incredible. And I'm getting a little bit of feedback. There we go. I want to brag on you all really quick about this logo. Fatima, can you show your shirt one more time, really quickly? So, all of you listening in today, something really incredible about this process that they went through in developing this logo. Like, they literally went through the entire design process from top to bottom. And one part that really stuck with me, when we brought to them several of the drafts, one of the drafts, if you see the little curve on the M right there at the bottom of the butterfly, it was initially attached to the butterfly, right? And we brought it back to them and all the girls were like, oh, absolutely not. The M cannot be attached to the butterfly. The butterfly needs to be free to fly on its own. Like, no. And even the colors, the gradient colors they chose because they wanted it to represent all girls. You all are absolutely incredible. So that's just one of the many things that you all have created. Callie, talk to me about some other things that you, the leadership team, has helped create for the GEM project.
Well, as a leadership team, we've created kind of like the toolkit that we want to teach the adults who will be helping with the program with, and the girls that will be helping with this program. More specifically, we did come up with the name as our council, as our group. We also, like Sequoia said, we worked on the logo and all the gradients and everything, but we also have really just put in a lot of work to create the foundations of this whole program. We started from scratch at the beginning. We had kind of an idea of what we wanted to do and how we wanted to do it. But this whole thing, this whole program that we've created has been created by us. I don't know how many people are on the council, but just by us girls. And it's really incredible to see how a kind of smallish group with just great minds can help create this wonderful program together.
That is awesome. And Callie, you actually were very instrumental in one particular part of the journal. Can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Sure. So to me, I think that if we're going to try to increase girls' health, we need to increase physical and mental health. And so my idea for the journal was to give these girls a mood tracker, which is basically this little image that you have every month and you have it color coded. So I actually do this in my journal. I think mine right now is a bubblegum machine. So I have a different bubblegum for every day. And I color code what I color in the bubblegum. So like if I'm feeling stressed, I think the color is yellow. So I'll color in the bubblegum for that day yellow. And then I take a minute and I think about like what has been making me feel stressed. And really it helps me figure out what I can do to make myself feel better during this time.
You know, when she shared that with us in one of the leadership team meetings, like we were all completely floored. And I think Caroline and I were both like, how can we get a journal with one of these mood trackers? Callie's also an incredible artist. So we're so grateful to have you all on here. And I don't think, is Ashaya back? Ashaya, can you hear us?
Yes, ma'am. What's up?
There you go. Yes, I can. So glad I can hear you. So I want to hear from you really quickly about how GEM has impacted you personally.
So GEM was something I never thought I would have been doing at this time and place, just because, you know, most people don't like working out or, you know, being physically active. But over the time I've been with all of y'all, you know, I've come to love it. And, you know, I love making people's day better, you know, giving them a smile, you know, one smile a day can take the pain away. But, you know, the thing about it is, like, GEM has impacted me growth-wise with my leadership skills and how I present myself to people and just how I carry myself. I carry myself a lot better knowing I'm doing something that's going to change the world.
I love that. Absolutely love that. And I can say that as much as you all have talked about how this project and the people working on this project with you have done for you have done that equally and beyond for us as adults. We appreciate you all so much for all that you're doing and how you about to shake stuff up. Like, Yeah, I'm super excited about it. So thank you so much, ladies. Thank you to all the funders that have helped thus far to make this extremely possible and make this a huge success. We're going way up this year, right? So can y'all one more time give them some claps, show them some love really quickly. Thank you again, ladies. Y'all are incredible. I want to introduce and bring to the stage Ms. Bonnie Hardage. She is the executive director of the Jesse Parker Williams Foundation, and she joined the foundation in 2016 after serving 17 years in healthcare marketing and development at St. Joseph's Health System, the Shepherd Center, and Mercy Care Foundation. Bonnie also serves on the board of Resilient Georgia. Everybody welcome Bonnie.
Thank you, Sequoia and Pratima, Gigi, Callie, and Ashia. Thank you for your leadership, your energy, your inspiration. This is phenomenal to see it all coming together and all your hard work being put forth that's going to help so many girls find their place in gyms and in their future. I'm one of those girls who played basketball in high school, and I just have so many great friends and memories of that experience, and can just see the bright light you guys are shining on the world. So thank you. I am here with a handful of leaders in the healthcare space and funder space, and I'm so grateful to moderate this discussion around investing in a sustainable model. I'd like to welcome Lauren and Debbie from the Atlanta Falcons Youth Foundation first to ask you, why do you think an investment in gyms is important at this time?
Hey, Bonnie, yes, thank you so much. Thank you for having us today, guys, and having us participate. And we really appreciate everyone who took the time to log in today and listen. I'm not sure if I can speak as eloquently and as powerful as the girls just did, but I'll try. So basically, we all saw the numbers at the beginning of the presentation, and those are the same stats that we would see within our grants committee meeting. So it's just something that we simply could not ignore. You know, when you hear Atlanta Falcons, you think boys, you think men playing sports, but as a youth foundation, we are dedicated to fighting childhood obesity in Georgia and improving fitness in Georgia for both girls and boys. So when we saw that disparity between the boys and the girls in middle school, we just knew we had to step in and take action. And that's kind of how this came to be and why we're so passionate about it today.
Yeah, and then, you know, just to build on what Lauren had just said, one of the sort of core values of the Blank family of businesses is listen and respond. And I think we just came off an incredible example of some really powerful girls who are shaping what this program looks like. And so for me, that was really one of the reasons why I wanted us to be able to support this and get behind it, was just that it's being driven and by such a wide range of girls. So we're understanding, you know, whether it's downtown Atlanta or rural Georgia, or all the different parts of the state that are going to have, you know, potentially different challenges, we're getting feedback from everybody. So, you know, it's just as being part of the committee and being part of this project is just really one of the most rewarding experiences that I've had my 5 years working with this organization. So thank you for everyone for including us and having us here today to talk about it as well.
Well, and I think from Jesse Parker Williams' perspective, we can't solve this problem alone. So I'm so grateful to be partnering with you and the other healthcare leaders and funders in this space. So I'm gonna invite Katie Heenan from Anthem. Katie, why did Anthem decide to commit valuable resources to this multi-year initiative?
Hi everyone, thanks for having me here today. This has been super inspiring. And at Anthem, we've been in Georgia for over 80 years and really focused on supporting our communities in an effort to improve health. In fact, we recently relaunched our mission, and it's to improve the health of humanity, which is a pretty lofty mission. And we are seeking to do that by supporting programs that promote whole health through equitable access to healthcare. But above and beyond that, we think you can't be healthy unless you have access to physical activity programming and safe places to exercise, nutritious food, equitable education and career development opportunities. And this theme's come up a lot today, which is mental health and wellness. And we just really feel like the GEM program brings so many pieces together. So we're really excited to be part of it. And I'd be remiss if I didn't call out that we are proud to have a female CEO of Anthem Inc., who coincidentally was a collegiate basketball player as well, Gail Boudreau, who has been recognized as one of the most powerful women in America. So we've got strong female representation here. Locally in Georgia, our Anthem Blue Cross and Blue Shield State Plan President, Pam Stahl, another great leader who had the opportunity to engage with some of the GEM leaders a few weeks ago and was also very inspired by this program. So we are making progress, but there's still an opportunity to improve where we are in terms of women leaders. And so this is a great opportunity to keep that pipeline full of fantastic girls and women. And we thank the girls that are here today. You guys were just really, truly inspirational.
Thank you, Katie. And then last but not least, Dr. Richeson from Peach State, along with Jaleesa, welcome. How does this initiative fit in your community strategy?
Good afternoon, everyone. Peach State Health Plan is so excited to be a part of this campaign. I definitely want to start off just to thank these young, amazing girls today on your platform. You guys absolutely rock. So hats off to each of you. But Peach State Health Plan mission is to improve the health of our communities, one individual at a time. This program, alongside our mission, provides these young girls healthy lifestyle habits. These girls will have their minds challenged, their voices heard, as well as have fun in the community. Health entails both physical and mental by incorporating physical activities and programs to increase and improve mental health. Now I will turn it over to Dr. Richeson to provide more insight on mental health.
Thank you. I can't really add much to everybody's said so many wonderful things. So I'm a psychiatrist. I actually also played college basketball. And just personally and professionally, I think Dr. Fitzgerald said it really well in saying that physical and mental health are just incredibly entwined. There's no way you can separate the two. And just getting people to be more physically active will, it builds their confidence. It builds their ability to work with others. It helps them, I think Dr. Coach Taylor said, you know, it helps them to learn how to deal with failure. I agree with that. I mean, there's so many different life lessons just from physical activity and sports. And yeah, just can't be emphasized enough how much that plays into both physical, mental, psychological health all across the board. So this is really exciting that there's a program for girls. I'm surprised by the statistics. That's a big disparity. And I'm glad that we have a program that's working on that. That's awesome. And girls, you guys did an awesome job talking. I love the energy that you guys have. It's contagious.
It is contagious. I think from Jesse Parker Williams Foundation standpoint too, as a funder, we're really trying, and I know everybody on the screen is really trying to figure out how to improve disparities and equity in healthcare. And our systems tend to spend a lot of money downstream. And the more we as philanthropy and as our health system progresses through the pandemic can move those investments upstream in health and well-being, we're going to see the long-term impacts return more than we've ever dreamed. And so GEMS is really investing in community leaders, these young women who are going to be able to provide peer support and also inspiration and energy to their friends and their family, but also be able to return that their whole lives long. And so it's really a beautiful thing to see. Thank you, Abby. I remember at a Grantmakers in Health conference about 2.5 years ago, learning about this program and the leadership that the Blank Foundation has had in this, along with Dr. Fitzgerald and the SHAPE program in Georgia, we can be an example for the nation. And thanks for all of your investments in this. We need more to make this even a better impact across the state. So thanks. And I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer Owens now to close us out. Jennifer.
Thank you. Thank you, Bonnie. Thank you, ladies. Thank you to everyone who's joined us today. My name is Jennifer Owens. I'm the president and CEO of Health Empowers, but I'm also the mom of a sixth grader. And I'm the mom of a sixth grader who has certainly found herself smack dab in the middle of that data point, really sort of turning inward or inward as the pandemic has hit. So for me, this program has a data imperative, but it's also a parental imperative. And I take that very personally. GEM is an exceptional model with national expansion implications. It's based on a collective impact model. We've got a lot of our partners on the call with us today, the Boys and Girls Clubs, the Girl Scouts of Historic Georgia, Girl Scouts of Greater Atlanta, the University of West Georgia. You've heard from many of the seed funders that have helped make this program possible. The program is grounded in evidence and research and will be a powerful antidote to what I see as three audacious goals. It's a preventative mental health program. Again, to Bonnie's point, let's go upstream. Let's stop just dealing with treatment downstream. We know in this moment that that is needed more than ever. It's an opportunity to improve the health of middle school girls, but also set the trajectory long-term that can have implications both on individual health, but also on our healthcare system and controlling healthcare costs and dealing with the root causes of preventative chronic conditions that so many adults and women in particular face. And finally, in this moment, after nearly 18 months of isolation and uncertainty, we have a unique opportunity to invest in youth leadership and develop voices. And you have seen a perfect example of that this afternoon. But we cannot do this without investment. We are so grateful that the Atlanta Falcons Youth Foundation, Anthem, Peach State Health Plan, the Jesse Parker Williams Foundation, Northside, and the Piedmont Bank have come to the table to provide seed funding to make this program possible, to get off the ground. But we are not where we need to be quite yet. Over the next 3 years, we are looking to raise an additional $1.2 million to support this project that will impact 120 sites across the state in nearly half of Georgia's counties, reaching hundreds of thousands of middle school aged girls. At an investment of roughly $10,000 per site per year, we can resource our girls to make a difference and really lean into all of the potential that this program offers. The return on investment on mental health, heart health, and leadership cannot be understated, especially now. Please reach out to me, to Health Empowers, so we can discuss the program, talk to you about a potential investment, answer any questions you have, and also just make sure that we continue to field the best team possible to set GEM, these girls that you've heard from today, and others just like them up for success. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'll look forward to following up with all of you, but if you're excited and you want to follow up now, Leanne will drop some contact information into the chat. Thanks again for spending your lunch with us. I am really excited about all that's to come. And as Coach Joni said, join us in leading the charge to change the trend lines for middle school aged girls and beyond in the state of Georgia. Thank you all so much and have a great afternoon. She's just a girl and she's on fire. Hotter than a fantasy, lonely like a highway. She's living in the world and it's on fire. Filled with catastrophe, but she knows she can find a way. Oh, 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 oh. She got both feet on the ground and she's burning it down. Oh,
Yeah. Awesome.
Whoop, whoop.
Although I'd love to sing, I just got a text from John Bear that said that that was the best Thunder briefing he had ever seen. Y'all, congratulations. And girls, you are the reason for the season and why we're here, but Health Empowers team, man. Gratitude for you right now. Thank you.
Girls, thank you so much for staying on. I would love to get a screenshot. I'm going to spotlight all of you again to get a screenshot because I failed to do that when we all were talking because I was so like motivated by the conversation. So let me pull the spotlight up for all of the girls.
Kendall, I don't know if you saw my message, but I think Gigi didn't see that she was supposed to stay on. So I think we could also pull a screenshot from... Well, we can do one now too, but we can also get one
with her. That's true, from the recording. I can just pull it from the recording.
Okay, that works.
Yeah, that should work just fine. But you did phenomenal. I don't know if y'all were following the chats or not, but we'll download the chats and send some of those comments to you because everybody was so impressed with your conversation. So thank you.
Keep telling y'all are dope.
Thank y'all so much. Tell your parents and caregivers thank you for allowing you to be here. I know some of y'all got to play hooky for the morning, which sounds really nice. So y'all are more than welcome to jump off, and we will see you tonight if you are joining our meeting.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, ladies.
Take care.
Thank you so much. Bye. Thank y'all.
Could they have been any better? I don't think so.
I'm going to stop the recording.
Okay.